indelible impressions of Damodar Kund. It's traditional to go on pilgrimage with the entire family, though in the present day circumstances it may not be feasible. In our group, spouses were conspicuous by their absence. My wife and I were desirous that we should have the holy darshans together, though aware that the Mukti Narayana darshan may not be possible that way. I told my wife, "Lakshmi, it looks as if we cannot have Mukti Narayana darshan together, despite our travelling to the holy place on the same day." She responded to it saying, "Things will happen as willed by the Almighty." My wife had left Pokhara by air for Jomsom in the early morning of 12th May 2009. Our other group travelling by helicopter reached Jomsom at around 11 a.m. only. Later, the helicopter left for Muktinath from Jomsom without our being certain about further journey to Damodar Kund. Subsequently, we did travel to Damodar Kund, and as we were returning to Muktinath from there, we could see from the helicopter some persons travelling by motorcycle to the Mukti Narayana shrine, kindling in me the hope that I may after all have the Mukti Narayana darshan in the company of my wife. When I disembarked from the helicopter, I could spot my wife treading towards the temple and Bengaluru Amma getting down from the pillion of a motorcycle. I hastened my steps from there and after joining my wife, expressed to her my joy at having seen Damodar Kund. We then started walking together towards the Mukti Narayana shrine. Though I could not have a bath in the Damodar Kund, I decided to have it at least in its holy water flowing down to Muktinath. When I had visited Muktinath in 2004, I could only sprinkle on my head the holy water spouting out of the 108 openings around the temple, designed like cow's face and called as Gomukha for that insignificance. This time I was intent on taking bath in the holy water jetting out of such orifices while circumambulating the shrine. Yes, they have all been set around the temple on its four sides in such a manner as to make available to the devotees the facility of having their bath at the holy precincts. The Gomukhas are discharging water round the clock, and it is a mystery how there is continuity in that and where such water comes from. It's possible that the water from the Damodar Kund at a higher altitude flows through the mountains to this place, or as mentioned earlier, water percolated and stored in the inner recesses of the earth as nature's wonder effuses in springs at various spots. This water flows to the Kali Gandaki River down below. And the place of its confluence with the river could be seen from above during the helicopter journey. When I was shivering in cold after my bath in the open, I asked Mohan Rao to take some pictures. But unfortunately, as the click button was not set properly, it turned out to be a vain attempt, though I had reenacted the scene of having my bath near the Gomukhas. Therefore, I had to repeat the action for a third time. But by then, I had got acclimatized to the chillness and its intensity was felt to be not so very biting. It was perhaps God's will that I should take bath thrice at that holy place. And when I recall that experience, it's truly spine tingling. Later, even as I was going with my wife for the Mukti Narayana darshan, the helicopter crew member came and told me to return soon. I asked him, "Where is the hurry now, unlike at Damodar Kund?" "We have to go to Pokhara by 3 p.m. and bring another group to this place," was the reply, to which I did not pay any attention and went straight inside the temple with my wife to have darshan of Sri Mukti Narayana. Our longing to have his darshan both together was thus fulfilled by the Lord, as indicated by my wife in her observation, "Things will happen as willed by the Almighty." The group that had travelled with us up to Muktinath in the helicopter, as also the others who had come there by a routine flight up to Jomsom and later travelled ascent by jeep and motorcycle ride had more than sufficient time for darshan of Sri Mukti Narayana and the other deities there. The latter group that included my wife had to return to Jomsom and stay there for the night, reaching Pokhara on the following day only. I took leave of my wife and the others after the Mukti Narayana darshan and wended my way to the helicopter. The flight to Jomsom airport was covered in just 18 to 20 minutes and it was drizzling when we touched down at that airport. The helicopter was again being filled with the fuel that had been drawn out of it earlier in the morning. At that juncture, I told the crew member, "You should be aware that what a big sum we all had paid for the Damodar Kund trip. Could you not have allowed us another 10 minutes stay there? What do you lose in this?" He replied, "Your anger is justified, but I shall explain to you our practical difficulties. You are a group of 24 persons that has travelled now. Instead, if only 12 passengers had come, of which 6 had disembarked at Muktinath and only an equal number had flown to Damodar Kund, we could have allowed another 10 or 15 minutes halt at Damodar Kund. If passengers are less, more fuel can be taken for the flight. Otherwise, with a heavy load, the helicopter cannot gain height and fly. It was because the fuel was less, we could not allow more time for you at Damodar Kund." I queried him whether they could not have taken passengers in two groups to Damodar Kund, but he had the quick and logical reply that the cost per head in that event would have been many times more, since fuel had to be filled only at Jomsom. He also explained that if perchance the helicopter was not in a position to fly to Damodar Kund again, those left behind at that place may be stranded there. And oxygen being less in those high altitudes, they would be able to breathe only for a limited duration, ultimately resulting in death by suffocation. I could not, of course, argue with the person that our travel agent had quoted the rate for 20 minutes stay at Damodar Kund for a group of 6. But I did pass the remark that for this 10-minute duration, we could have just circled Damodar Kund and returned, to which he retorted that it could be done that way on the next occasion I come for this trip. From Jomsom, the helicopter came to Pokhara well past 3 p.m. when it was raining there too. Next day, my wife and others of our group came from Jomsom to Pokhara after an overnight stay there. The 120-kilometer distance between the two places had to be covered by flight only. We stayed in Jomsom that day and went around the place. When the other group joined us the following day, we all went to the legendary place of Gajendra Moksha and had its holy darshan. Later, we reached Lumbini and by our own efforts crossed the border and got into the available conveyances and reached Gorakhpur by midnight, all at our own expense. We took lodging there at our cost and the next morning took a train to Chennai, reaching our destination on May 18th at about midnight. The Mylapore lady was taken to task at every stage by most of those in the travel group for her inefficient management, despite the substantial amount she had collected from the group as all-inclusive charges for the yatra. Though our group members too felt indignation, we looked after ourselves, making our own arrangements wherever necessary. Bhajans and songs by Balaji Rao and Mohan Rao made us forget our agonies, and not to be outdone, Mrs. Balaji Rao prepared and served coffee for us, even in the running bus. We bought and shared whatever fruits and edibles were available on the way to stave off our hunger. Annanagar Nagarajan's hilarity provided us revelry at its best. Thus, we had to adjust ourselves at various stages to the prevailing circumstances and conditions, sequel to the failures of the travel agent. Many yatrikas often return disappointed without having darshan due to unfavorable weather conditions. That way, all the 150 who had travelled from Chennai at that time had excellent darshan, thanks to the grace of the Almighty. Even after returning to Chennai, I could not get over the feeling of being in Damodar Kund, visualizing still the imaginary picture of Sri Guru Raja's face in the yellow-tinted mountain range, with the snow-capped mountain tops providing the semblance of his white beard. I longed to visit the holy place again and pray to Sri Guru Raja to give me good health and financial support for that, for which I am prepared to wait until such time as I am graced that favor. Of course, there will be unceasing efforts on my part towards achieving that end, with the blessings of the Guru and the grace of the Almighty. Guru Raja, it is you who have taught me to wait with forbearance to achieve my cherished objectives. Oh, how long you had carried the mritikas of your gurus while going on yatra, and later caused their installation and consecration at a holy place where you yourself made your advent too. And you have graced me to write about those incidents after making me wait for so long, Sri Guru Raja. Truly, you are the one to help me any time, even in my future births, O Sri Raghavendra. I prayed soulfully from the depths of my heart. Though we are prone to be always impatient, the advantages of waiting with the tolerance is the lesson to be learnt from the incident that follows in the next few pages.